Hello everyone, welcome to the first lecture of unit 4. So in unit 3 we saw the basic and the stock synthesis flow. The unit 4 requires that you are familiar with unit 3, you are comfortable with design compiler or working with design compiler. You should be very comfortable in reading the RTL design, analyzing the errors, analyzing the elaborate report, setting up the constraints and doing a basic compile. Now many times there are designs that are that have very difficult goals that are either very area intensive or very time intensive. So design compiler does provide us with a lot of tools and commands and options so that we could tackle these problems and use them to fine tune our design. So it is very important before going to this unit to go back to unit 3 and clarify whatever doubts you have. The agenda is that I'll introduce all the features, all the advanced features for getting lower area or a better timing, better performance are contained, majorly contained in the command called compile ultra. So compile ultra is the much more advanced form of compile. So whatever we discuss in this session is majorly, will be majorly about compile ultra. Most of the things are done under the hood and are not transparent to us, but some of the things are, we can control some of the things and tweak them to suit our needs. So I will introduce compile ultra. We look at something about FSM optimization, we look at the options path group and critical range, what are they, how are they used. Then there is something called advanced critical path resynthesis, we will see how they will be tackled. We will see about auto ungrouping, then we will see cost priority, compile directives. There are quite a few slides about data path optimization, which will be very interesting. We will relook at the compile ultra options again, and lastly, the slightly more complex topic, register retry. So, DC ultra, the compile ultra, so DC launched the regular compile is called DC expert. So, DC launched a command called compiler. First, DC launched a feature called DC ultra. So, there was a command called set ultra optimization. You had to set that variable to true to enable that. But now, everything, all set functionality comes under the hood of the command compile ultra. So, it's the full strength of DC ultra in a single command. Now, these slides are by Synopsys. So, there would be obviously some marketing terms involved here. So what DC ultra enables us to do, it enables us to do FSM optimization under the hood, extensive data path optimization. So earlier, back in early 2000s, there was a tool by design compiler called module compiler. Module compiler was specifically built to tackle complex data paths. Data path means all the operations like addition, subtraction, multiplication, shifting, comparators and so on. So now all that functionality of module compiler is now extinct. Actually, all that functionality is brought under compile ultra. So it identifies arithmetic operations, it will provide a common engine to optimize data path for. So data path will need optimization across various tools. So the optimization does not end once you specify. The backend tools also do some optimizations based on placement and routing data. So then there are some options we'll see critical path synthesis. It also allows us to change to control the cost function priorities. Then DC ultra compile ultra also gives us option to automatically ungroup modules based on either area or time. Then let's see the DW foundation. So the new DW foundation, so the latest DW foundation libraries have support for all these things. It has support for ISP data path components, it has it even has an unbound zipper that is used for ARM it has microcontrollers, then memory IPs, then verification IPs of standard buses. So it has a large collection of adders, subtractors and multipliers with various implementations like carry select, carry look ahead, then for multipliers it has booth coded forest tree, non-booth coded forest tree. So the codes here that you see, the code like RPCS, CLF, so just note it down, they will be available to, you can see that as part of the report resources. Then, so how do we, just a reminder, how do we make sure that DW library is read? We have to select, set the variable synthetic library to DW foundation.fldb, and we have to append this to the link library, right? You could set this in Synopsis setup. I believe in the latest versions now, the design there is loaded by itself often as you do compiler. You don't have to do anything like this now. You can try it out in the lab. So as I told you, these are there are some marketing slides here. So it also tells what are the new designer functions. It is specific to a particular version. So these slides are dated somewhat I think few years back. So these are now not new features. These are the features that are already available to you. It supports lot. So I believe in the later part, whatever version you are using of it in the lab will have many more designer functions over and above this. So to know more about this, you can go to Prolnet to see some of the documentation. So it has lot more arithmetic functions, saturation, time multiplier, absolute value. There is a graphics alpha blender which is used for video applications and so on. So video applications typically require a lot of data path functions, so designer has support for a lot of these. Let's look at the FSM compiler now. The design compiler by default has features for automatic FSM dependency and extraction. Extraction means that from the elaborated design, DC knows that what all flops are part of the finite state machine. And then, so there is a variable called FSM auto inferring, which default value. Now, default value might have been 10, you can verify by doing a print bar on this variable in the system, but what is the default value. So, usually the FSM flow is already enabled. And you can just do a compiler try and it will do the job. You don't have to do anything specific. However, there is something called state minimization. What it does is that if some states are unused, then DC has a capability of removing and optimizing of those states. So this feature is not enabled by default. The reason is that the state minimization is a complex process. And we tools that do a formal verification. So formal verification is a way by which we can verify that the gate level netlist we have is functionally equivalent to the RTL mode. Now it's not to verify whether the tool is correct or not. Tool does the job based on our commands and constraints. It may happen that a mistake happens in issuing a command to the tool. For example, I could force the port to logic 0 while compiling by mistake. So DC will optimize off that the logic connect to that code. But when I do formality, when I do an equivalence check, I find that my RTL and my netlist are not matching. Why? Because by mistake I did a constant 0 on one particular code. So formal verification is a very sophisticated, very good method to verify that the RTL matches the netlist. You can even compare netlist versus netlist or RTL versus RTL. Formal means that it's a static approach. It is not based on any vectors. It is not a simulation. It just compares the truth tables. It makes logic cones in both reference and implementation design. And at each of it has something called a compare point. At each of those compare points, it will verify whether the logic cone is equivalent across both the designs. So if we enable state minimization, then there are problems we can encounter in formal verification, because formal verification does not understand the concept of state minimization. So if you are using formal verification, then you have to be very, very careful when you enable this. It might lead to some problems, so that is why it is turned to false by default. So design compiler has some formality support in the sense that it will write out some files which formality can formality is again a tool from Synopsys. So it can read those files and understand what design compiler has done. So there is a variable called FSM export formality state input. Again, so it is again recommended here that common methods do not support state minimization, so you should use FSM enable state minimization with great care. Right. Now, so recommendation, there is nothing special you can you should do for FSM state recognition, it will be automatically done under the hood. And however, you can enable this variable for state minimization, which I would recommend not to use at the first instance. These whatever methods we are discussing here are used for very, very special cases. When there is a case, let's say you are not meeting a timing constraint on a particular task on a small part of the design, you can employ these techniques. Now let's look at creating path groups. So we have there's a concept, there's a mechanism by which we can do certain amount of some paths, any path. So usually, what a design compiler would do is it will break all timing paths into groups. The group is defined by the capture clock. So the clock that captures the data, the name of that clock is the group name. So if let's say there is no capture clock, then it will come to a default clock group or a none, which is called also for none. You can see I have discussed this in the lab section also. Now, so all paths not associated with the clock are in the default path group. Now, if a design has complex clocking or complex timing requirements or complex constraints, any of this case, one can create path groups to focus DC on special critical paths, specific critical paths in a design. Now, so by default, DC will create, let's say you have 5 groups. So by default, DC will create 5 clock groups. Plus one default group for paths that are not coming under each of these 5 clock groups. Now it will try to meet the timing requirement for each group. It will try to make the WNS 0 for each clock group. And if for a particular path clock group it is not able to meet timing, it will affect the timings of the same group but not the other group. That means irrespective of the timing, how the timing looks in one path group, it will optimize the other group. So by creating a different group, so by default design compiler, this is the statement to remember, design compiler works only on the worst volatile input. The optimization can be controlled by creating and prioritizing path groups which affect only the maximum delay possible. Apart from, so you can create a group, a special let's say you know that one path is very critical in your design. You can create a separate group even though the DC will by default create a path group based on the capture block, but you could create a group for that special path and give any name to it. Now if even if you don't set higher priority to it, DC will try to make WNS of this path group. So first thing you try, but without increasing the priority. Other option is that you could set the path group priorities by assigning weights to each group. The default weight is 1.0, which is a default. Otherwise, the weights can be from 0 to 100. This is one example that to indicate that the path from input IN3 to flip flop 1 is the highest priority path. We can use this kind of a command, group path. This is a string, it can be renamed from IN3 to FF1D. This is the path we wanted to optimize with higher priority, and we have increased the weight to 2.5. So, this is the way you can pick and choose paths and tell DC to work more on some groups or less on other groups, right. So there's a very good example in the last four of design compiler where I have discussed what I have done is that first I have made all the input group, all the paths starting from input or ending at output as a register to this, all will be non groups, and I have compared those timing reports to the case where I create separate groups for input register path and register output path. Please go through that example in lab 4, it is a very good example to understand how group path works and how DC optimization works, right. Okay, now other concept is of optimizing near critical path. Now by default in a particular path group, if DC finds that WNS is 0, it will stop the optimization process. What it means, and it will proceed to area recovery. It will not do any delay optimization because it has already met the goal. Now let's say you want that DC should not stop at 0 WNS. Let's say you want DC to fix timing till let's say plus 100 by picoseconds. It can be a special requirement for a particular code. So there's a concept called critical range. So critical range is the parameter that defines the maximum delay for a function, and if we change it, we can when we add a critical range to a path group, we change this function from WNS to critical negative path. So by default is always WNS, target is WNS for each path group to be 0, but by applying this critical range we are changing the maximum delay for function from WNS to CNS, which is called critical negative path. And DC will optimize all paths between this critical range, within this critical range. Obviously specifying it will mean that DC will have to work more, and so therefore it is recommended to use critical range only during the final implementation phase when you are very sure that you want this to happen. The guideline is you should not specify critical range which is more aggressive than 10% of the clock period. So critical range option is available to you as part of the group path command. So in this earlier path, this minus weight tells DC that this is of a higher priority. Further you could add a minus critical range option here to tell DC to what slack it should fix, right. Again, so you could use a group path or you could use simply set critical range. Set critical range you can set at a particular design and a particular cell and so on. Please read the man page for technical rules for more information. Now let's see a concept which is called advanced critical path reconfiguration. Now DC performs, now let's say you have compiled a design and found that design is violating by somehow. Now in the second phase, what you can tell DC is that do a compile minus map effort. So this is an option of compiler. Compiler has this advanced critical path synthesis under the hood, but usually compile option the map effort is set default value is set to median. So when you do a median, if you are meeting the timing goals, you don't need to come here, use this option, but if you are not meeting your timing goals, you can use this. And the strategies include this, one of the two of the most famous strategies are aggressive logic duplication and improved technology mapping. Let's see what it means. So this is one example where this is the critical path from this, the green thing represents, the green line represents the critical path, goes through logic, the blue bubble here, and to the critical pin named critical. So during advanced CPR, what DC can do, it can break this logic and restructure it into such a manner that critical, it made the critical path smaller in terms of the delay. So so A and B are not critical, so it will duplicate the logic. Now this restructured logic at the top which feels critical will be optimized for delay. And the one, this one below, since path to A and B is not critical, it will not be, the cells here will not be upsized as much. So the logic is duplicated here, obviously area is increased, but then you want the timing to be short on the critical bit. One more example could be resizing along the critical path. Now let us say before the drivers are 1x, 1x, 1x peak critical. After these drivers are upsized and the drivers may be in the code, this code of logic also are upsized, that feed to the critical one, right. So but these things only happen for critical paths, not for all the paths. What are the critical paths? Critical paths are the paths with worst negative slack in each path. How do we enable this? We tell compile minus map buffer time. Now in many cases compile minus map buffer time takes a long amount of time to process. So you should only do this first, you should try compile, compile or compile ultra. If it works fine then good, if not you can use this compile minus map buffer time to see if after doing critical path resynthesis your design needs timing. Okay. It needs a DC ultra license again. So then DC compile ultra supports auto ungrouping. Compile also supports auto ungrouping. So auto ungrouping will allow DC to merge cells and optimize logic. So if there are like the module Verilog module will create an artificial boundary, right? And if there are too many small combination clouds of logic that talk to each other across these logical hierarchies, then DC cannot optimize them effectively. If we let DC to ungroup them, remove the hierarchy, then many small cones of logic put together, clouds of logic put together can help DC to optimize it more effectively, right. So it improves, it also improves the timing because now you can again. So any kind of optimization like this which ungroups the hierarchies will help you in both timing and area, right. You can the logic can be shared, let us say there are adders which can be shared, so again area and timing will both improve. So the graphic here shows it that this this part of combination logic here, there are 3 parts of combination logic between these 2 blocks. Obviously optimizing them each of them individually, it is better to optimize them combined together. Area and timing of the second circuit will be better than the first one. Further you can extend this further, you can combine all these 3 together in one big combinational cloud, you can even ungroup this. So one level of ungroup you can do by setting, so manual ungroup you can do by setting it using the command set ungroup. And you can ungroup all, you can use ungroup minus all which will remove all hierarchy from the design to make the design flat. You can use the ungroup command to ungroup a specific part of the design. Now over and above this, over and above manual ungrouping that DC allows you to do, there is an option called auto ungrouping. So one is block size based ungrouping, where you say that okay, all the blocks that have the cell count smaller than this number, please ungroup it, right. So the default for this variable, you can use a variable to control this, compile auto ungroup area number of cells, default is 30. By default area and delay ungrouping count only the child cells in the immediate hierarchy, and the child cells in sub design are not considered. You can again use this variable to change the behavior, compile auto ungroup count leaf cells. Now so compile has 2 options, compile minus auto ungroup based on area or delay. We can explicitly I've told you before, we can explicitly ungroup a particular module by using the ungroup command, or on the other hand if we want to prevent some block to be ungrouped, we don't want a particular block to be ungrouped, we can set don't touch on it, or we can set ungroup calls on a particular design, right. This is a example script. So the compile auto ungroup area number of cells, we have changed the value, the default is 30, we have changed it to 180. So this is the design we are talking about. We don't want ALU to be ungrouped, so ALU is set ungroup to false. We don't touch mem control, but please make sure if we say don't touch on MEM control, MEM control should already be mapped. It should not be an RTL form, otherwise DC will not even do nothing. We set ultrop, so this command is no more needed in the later version for DC. You can just use compile ultrop, or in this case you can just use compile minus map upper type auto ungroup area. So in this case we are enabling the critical path resynthesis. We are also saying it to ungroup based on area. We can report auto ungroup by saying report auto ungroup. It will tell us what are the designs that are ungrouped, and it looks like this. MEM control is remains as it is, ALU remains as it is, ALU because we set ungroup on it, MEM control because we set don't touch on it, B is ungroup, C is ungroup, and auto ungrouping it will give us this, right. You can try that out again in the lab. Now there is something called critical path auto ungrouping. So earlier what we saw was mostly area based ungrouping. So for critical path ungrouping is usually compile ultra has a feature where by default it will do critical path by default. To prevent it, however, we have seen that this in lab 2 I guess, that if we do not specify anything to compile ultra, just do compile ultra. So compile ultra will ungroup the small designs based on the binary. To prevent this ungrouping, this is critical path auto ungrouping. To prevent this, we have to set a variable, or we have to say compile ultra minus no auto ungroup, right. So but obviously the advantages for ungrouping are many, that there is a lesser area and better path applies. It is only applies to critical path with negative slack, delay improvement for more consistent and more predictable. Now we talked about FSM extraction, we talked about critical path resynthesis, and we talked about ungrouping. So just to summarize, for FSM extraction you do not need to do anything special, compile ultra is good enough. Again for critical path resynthesis you have an option called compile minus map effort high, but better than that I would recommend go for compile ultra. Third thing, for auto ungrouping, compile ultra supports auto ungrouping by default. To prevent that you have to give minus no auto ungroup in compile ultra. So for all three things we have seen before, instead of using compile, if you use compile ultra you get everything under the hood, you do not have to worry about all the work. But it is good to know how were things done 2 years back, or what are the options available to me. Right, it is always good to know the options available there. Now let us look at something which is independent of either compile or compiler. This command set cost priority lets you change the cost function priority list according to which DC will optimize. Usually the priority runs like this, connection class, you can read more about it in the manual. I will explain it here. It is then again multiple port nets, the min fan out bin capacitors, these are top 4 which are usually the highest priority, and for your simple design and simple one single voltage case usually you won't encounter any such constraint, either connection class or min fan out or min capacitors. Usually these are encountered less in when we in case of simple design and simple logic. Right. Connection class comes into picture when we have multiple voltage cells, multi voltage design, you support multi UT cells and multi voltages, and you have signals crossing those voltage domains. Multiple port nets, again design specific. Usually I do not see a lot of min fan out and min capacitance. Major things are these: max transition, max fan out, max cap, and degradation does not apply to our course, it is mainly used by DC turbographic analysis. And max delay, min delay, max power, max area. So this is the default priority in direction of this arrow, and among out of these the ones covered in blue are user prioritizable. This is the default one, but we could, using the command set cost priority, we can change the priority. And this is the syntax. No need to do anything if you are using the default feature. Default is fix DRC first, then go to timing. Delay means max delay has higher priority than max design rule. You could actually try and use this. Let's say if your design has timing violations and it needs DRC, you can actually try do the other way around. You can set cost priority minus delay and see if your design has better timing. Again, specify that min delay has higher priority than max delay but lower priority than max design rule. This is a very strange feature to have. I am not even haven't used it till now. I'm not sure who would want to solve whole timing problems in Vue synthesis, but it's there. So be careful about using it. I would recommend never use it. There can be some special case which I will not think of it now. And again, there is a very customizable cost list where you can set the priorities among all these customizable checks, customizable cost functions. So this is an example where usually max timeout comes before max delay, but now you now we have said that okay, max delay comes before max timeout. Again, this is a very special this we would use in a very special cases, in very special cases where you probably you are running trials where you want to see if the design rules clash with the design, the max delay and the min delay. So these are mostly for experiments. Please be careful before using set cost priority. It will definitely affect your optimization. Now DC allows greater control over some. Now optimization, typical optimization contains lot of phases. So DC allows for a greater control over different strategies. Some of the strategies are cost, constant propagation, deletion of unconnected gates, local optimization, critical path synthesis, gate sizing, and example strategies. Now you could individually turn among this four of these, you can individually turn off and on. By default, all around. This command to do this is called set compile directive. One of the things you could turn on and off is critical path synthesis. So usually critical path resynthesis is set to true, but let's say when you do a compile with a default media method, so the extent of critical path resynthesis is comparatively less, which is controlled by this. If you specifically give compile minus map effort high, that means you are asking DC to do more of critical path resynthesis. So again, these two or three options are first they have similar usage, but the extent to which the effort optimization differs. So here in this case we can set critical path resynthesis to be either true or false. By default it's set to true. So something like this, let's say f is critical, then this cloud of logic before f is equal to ah plus bh bar plus cd, after critical path resynthesis these two clouds are combined and now f has some function. AD bar plus BD, I'm not sure what this means here, maybe it's a typo, whatever. The function remains same, but the critical path is grouped and re-implemented like this. A portion of the critical design's critical path is grouped, so these two are grouped because F is the critical point and they are re-implemented to improve timing. This is enabled during high effort compile. You could, if you want, you could set this false, but it's again a question that if you are using compile minus map effort high, that means you want DC to perform critical path resynthesis, right? Then there's something called constant propagation. So let's say you have ports, design ports tied off to 1 or 0. You might have 1 or 0 on the ports of some design you have instantiated. So DC will propagate that and it will optimize of the gates based on these values. For example, here the AND gate is tied to 0. If this becomes 0, if this becomes 0, this becomes 1, if this becomes 1, this function becomes A. So DC will do this kind of thing. This is a very basic level of optimization. Ideally it is on and it should be on, because these are the things, the constant values affect a lot of optimization in a design. So by default it is on, but somebody who might want to keep the gates in there which are tied to constants may turn it to false, and obviously the area will be more. Third thing is deletion of unconnected gates. Again, if the gate is unconnected, then DC will use a value such that, so the gate is unconnected, let's say a gate is unconnected, so what DC will do is it will remove it simply. So here for example there will be an X propagation, because in simulation there will be an X propagation because this value is unknown. So what DC will do, it will just remove this corner block which is right there, because X probably is not used. I think X will not be used further. That is why DC removes all this logic connectivity. Again, this is one of the basic optimization techniques. You could turn it off by using set compile directive minus delete and loaded delete with false, set this to false. Fourth is called local optimization. So DC performs optimization within the neighborhood of a given cell to improve timing and area. So the option is called local optimization. Example is fan out optimization. So for example, this gate here has a large fan out and this is a critical path. So what DC could do is that it can clone this NAND gate and put one more NAND gate here which has same input conditions here, and it will drive this critical one using, so that it will have a single fan out here, and then it can probably downsize it, right? So because whatever, so or it can upsize this one and so on. So these are the optimization which occur in the gates that are in the neighborhood of the critical path, the critical path, right? Again you could turn it off, but I will not recommend it. So in summary, they are all defaulted to true and any one can be turned off. Again the recommendation is not to play with this. The idea is to first synthesize the design, see if it meets timing goals. So these are the other way around, but other way around. Now you would obviously not do this if the design is meeting your, now if your design is meeting your timing goals and you don't have anything any special requirement, you will not do. In cases, for example, the constant propagation. Now let's go back. Why would I need to turn it off? Now let's say, now I am not sure about this value, whether it's 0 or 1, and this is connected to something. I am not sure what this value would be. Now I can choose this constant propagation. I can turn this off. So DC will keep all these gates, and then I can probably change the value here and see how it affects. But if I turn this on, if I let it to be the default value, all the gates would be removed and I will not have the flexibility to check what happens if this pin is 0 or 1 in the gate. So again there can be very special cases where you want to turn one of these compile directives to off, and obviously in these cases you are not worried about area or time, because all of these cases if you turn off, the area will be worse, timing might also be worse. Okay, now let's look at DC ultra data path optimization. The compile ultra compared to compile command delivers a better QR for design containing arithmetic operators. It has comprehensive data path extraction, multiplication, addition, subtraction, comparators, muxes. It employs timing driven resource sharing. It has support for carry chain implementation, support for bit truncation. You see examples of this. So the best thing is that you don't have to do anything. Compile ultra does everything for you. You just have to see what it actually does. So after the design is read and analyzed, elaborated, during the compile, during the stage that during which compile ultra runs, PC ultra will run something called data path exception. And then it will start choosing design by library components which best suit this data path, and then it will proceed to logic optimization before going on to mapping. So ultra data path optimization is something that runs under the hood during compile ultra. There is no other command, there is no special separate command to do this. So for example, let us look at carry save adder transformation. So conventional arithmetic, you have A minus B, C plus B, E plus F, and then these two are added together and then there is one more adder. So usually if you draw it on paper, there will be carry propagate adders, addition will be done in group of 2, and you should understand that is the carry bit that takes the longest amount of time to go from the input to the output. So let us say in this path there are 3 adders, 1, 2, 3. So it is the carry bit that will take the maximum delay. So typically the complete computation at the end of each operator, so at the end of this operator, this will represent the true value of C plus C. Carry propagate adders are either of a ripple kind or carry look ahead or carry select. They are slow and they are large, the traditional adders. What ultra supports is something called carry save adder. Now in this case, addition can be done in group of 3, and the outputs here, they are partially computed, they are not final A plus B plus C, they are partially computed and fed here to another carry save adder. And now in the end we employ a traditional carry propagate adder which will do this final addition. Now in this case the intermediate points, they do not represent the actual addition, they are partially computed. So that what it does is that it improves speed and it makes sure that the carry does not become a critical path. So but the flip side is that the intermediate points here, they are not the values which you should expect. So for example, the intermediate point here is not actually A minus B plus C, right. So but the addition, the final value of y here is exactly same, right. So again example of data path transformation, here there are 2 multiplication and addition. So what DC will do is it will try and do addition first and then do a multiplication. So this is A into B plus A into C. So it will do so B and C are common here, so it will do a B plus C and then into A. So it knows that from your expression, it will know that it will do a proper transformation and it will do resource sharing to make sure that circuit meets the timing requirement, right. Repetitive addition optimization, for example, z is equal to x plus y here. If you solve this, it will come to 2a plus 4b, and 2 into a means a left shifted by 1, 4 into b means b left shifted by 2, and then added together. So based on these expressions, DC is able to know that it is able to calculate the optimal number of operators needed. One more example is partial constant optimization. Now let us say you have constant bits. So for example, B 0 left shifted by 3 will be padded with zeros. Again C 0 left shifted by 3 will be padded with zeros. So this logic here in the circle here is redundant. You do not need an adder to compute this, right. So this is transformed, so this is removed. Constraints are optimized and the tree is reduced. So the final adder is 1 bit instead of 4 bits. So here they are 1, 2, 3 and 4. 4 additions taking place, but after optimization, after doing a partial constant optimization, this is removed and only 1 level of addition is done, right. So obviously a great area saving is made by DC. So enabling is simple. Again, the designware license is required, for data path optimization. Designware library should be is enabled automatically once you run compile alpha, runs under the hood. It's on by default, and the command we have we saw this command in the lab 4 of design compiler of unit 3. We saw a command called resource resources, which will list out all the data path resources used inferred by design compiler. It will tell what is the implementation that it chose. It will tell what is the module name of the data path it chose. It will tell what are the operations that are going on in that module, and so on. So the synthesis methodology is that avoid expensive carry propagation. When you have additions, when you do additions that are multi, that are like more than 2 or 3, it's the carry bit that takes the longest to arrive at the output, right? So avoid expensive carry propagation. Use redundant representations like carry save and partial product. It uses high level arithmetic optimization, and it tries to apply these techniques in the largest possible data path partition. We will come to that, what does a largest possible data path partition mean. So what DC will try to do is that it will try to extract the largest possible data path block from the elaborated RTM. So one of the examples can be a sum of products type of expression. So in this case, any arbitrary sum of products can be implemented. So one data path block means that, let's say you write such an expression, z is equal to a and b, a into b, sorry, this is the multiplication, a multiplied by b plus c multiplied by d plus some constant into e plus f minus d plus some constant. Now such sum of product can be, so this the it's actually a very compute intensive expression, right? There are so many multiplications and addition and subtraction. All of these DC will determine can be done inside one module. So just by writing this expression, DC will now instantiate one module. And if you notice in lab 4 of design compiler, we saw that when we chose when we told DC not to ungroup DW during compile alpha, it actually gave us that module, right? It gave us that module name also. So it chooses one module in which it will implement all of these. Now the benefit of choosing one module is that all such operators are already ungrouped inside that module, and DC can do aggressive optimization and resolution, right? Again, limited product of sum can be implemented in one data. So what it will do is that it will employ the whatever addition technique we saw earlier, this kind of addition technique, and make sure that the final, it will need only one CPA in the final stage to implement it, right? Otherwise all other points would be redundant, they will be partial expressions. So in one data path block with one CPA. Again, POS limited can be implemented in one data block with one CPA. Select off operations are considered to be data paths. So it will what it will do, it will try to, so such an expression, it will try to implement it in such a manner that there won't be any carry propagation before the select off. So carry propagation is always the last step. Right. Again, comparisons are similar. For example, T1 is equal to A plus B, T2 is equal to C into D, and Z is equal to T1 greater than T2. So comparisons will be implemented on redundant internal results, that is without CPA before the comparison. So CPA is again the last step to be done. Right. So largest possible data path blocks are extracted from RTL code. The expressions operators are merged into data path blocks. We will see an example. So extraction can occur only when operators are directly connected without any non-arithmetic logic in between. chain of arithmetic operations against swap type expressions are extracted. These are the operators that are extracted as part of data path. Operators involving bit truncations are extracted. What is not extracted is shifters and equality comparators. So equality comparators are implemented somewhat differently. They use XOR gates. So and XOR gates are a different sort of gates altogether. They are not typically very similar to AND and OR gates in terms of what optimizations can be done on them. So therefore they are not extracted. So benefits of extraction. So when we say extraction, it means that DC is able to understand the functionality and it will try to implement that functionality as part of a single module. The benefit is that it can share data path operators, it utilizes carry save arithmetic techniques. High level arithmetic optimizations are carried out on extracted data path blocks and explores better solutions that might involve a different resource sharing configuration. So there might be some resource sharing cases which we might not have envisioned at the time of writing of the RTL, but then DC will try and figure out if it can do better resource sharing by looking at your extracted data path, and it will implement that. So recommendation is to use report timing to check timing and optimization results, and use report resources to determine which operators were absorbed into the data path. Obviously always checking the warning messages is always recommended. So again this slide tells that what generation strategy, there are some intelligent generation strategies for better QoR. Mapping of data path special cells, OSC2 compressor, boot encoder, carry select adder, inverting full adder and so on. So it automatically selects boot or non-boot encoding for multipliers based on a design goal. So now with we will see an example, but the most important point here is that you will, while using compiler draft, and if you have the design and assets available with you, you will not be, as an RTL designer, you will not be concerned about what implementation is being used. You should only be concerned about your logic. So score the logic defined by the specification of the architecture. When you start coding, you can use adder, you can use multipliers, you can simply use plus and multiplication and minus one, and do everything what you want. And now obviously following the different various guidelines that we have talked about RTL coding, about logical partitioning, about and then so on, right? Not creating artificial boundaries and so on. And now let DC extract the data function. So again, you don't have to do anything special for it. The compile ultra command will extract the data path for you. You can use report resources to list down all those data paths, to list down what all DC extracted, what all it is implemented. And then after resource sharing and after choosing the after extracting the data path, now DC will go on and it will choose the implementation based on the design code. Right? So that's what it says here. It selects, for example, for multiplication, it will select boot or non-boot encoding, and the decision is always based on the design goals, right?